Good morning, everyone. Welcome to today's Healthy Aging Lecture. It's 11 o'clock. I'm going to give it just another minute or two to get started, and then we'll introduce our speaker today and get on with the topic. So we'll be right with you in just a couple minutes. So okay, well, let's get started. Again, welcome everyone to this month's Healthy Aging Lecture. It's going to be on the topic of senior travel. I hope you are all eager to kind of bust out and think about some new places to go in the year ahead. My name's Kate Kwapi. I'm the manager of senior health here at Virginia Hospital Center. And Blanca is my co-worker there. You probably also see her on the screen. We work together in the senior health department. Before I get going with introducing our speaker today, I just want to remind all of you about our kind of housekeeping tips for enjoying the webinar as best as possible. So you're all joined in listen-only mode, so that will help reduce any of that background noise. But we definitely encourage and welcome your questions. So please orient yourself. There should be a question box in your control panel. And that's a great place to type in any questions or comments. Blanca and I will look at them throughout the presentation and be sure to get them to our presenter. I also want to let you know that this webinar is being recorded. So everyone who registered for this webinar will get a copy of this recording. You can listen to it at any time, and you can share it with any family or friends. And I also wanted to point out, this is kind of the first time we've done this, but in the handout section of the control panel, there's a nice handout that Andrea put together. So if you're able to go into that and look at it or download it on your computer, that's awesome. But I also want to assure you, I'm going to send that also with the follow-up email. So it'll be an attachment there as well. But I just wanted to point that out if anybody wants to take a look as we're going along. Okay, so let me go ahead and introduce our guest speaker today. We are really delighted to have Andrea Savitch with us this morning. Andrea is the owner of Unique Travel Events, which is a full-service travel company. She has over a decade of experience working with travelers, whether they're individuals, families, or groups. She's also developed an expertise in working with older adults and helping to provide some great guidance and tips. She's traveled to over 6 continents and over a dozen countries. She has a lot of great experience. She's got a lot of accomplishments with different travel lines, cruise services, hotels, that type of thing. So she brings some good experience with her, which we're delighted to have. Andrea, I'll let you just jump in and take it away from here, and give us your presentation. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you, Kate, and thank you everybody who is joining the presentation. I am always delighted to share a little bit about travel. It is a passion of mine, and I have been doing it for a while. And for us seniors, and I am in that category, it can be a little bit different. And things have definitely changed definitely over the past year and over the course of time. So I want to share with you a little bit about where to go, when, why, and how. I'm going to start with one of the best places. Okay, I'm waiting for, where can we go? America, the beautiful. We have an amazing country. There's so much for us to see. And with the COVID situation, this is probably the easiest place for us to visit because we already know what the rules are. From sea to shining sea, whether you want to go to a big city, whether you want to go to a small town, and there are a lot of really interesting small towns in America, some of which have halls of fame, it's great to go. And the USA is really set up for seniors to travel. For the most part, they are aware of sometimes our limitations and a lot of times what our experiences and what we need and what we want. And because we have so many different climates, you can pick a place, winter, summer, spring, or fall, and you can find a place to go in the USA. So that is what I will tell you. If you're anxious to get out and you've already seen the kids and the grandkids, and I was lucky enough to do that a little bit earlier in the year, you want to see things. And one of the best things about travel is learning. And it's what's good for us, because the more we learn, the better we are. It just keeps those brains moving, as we all know we need to do. Couple of places that you can visit that outside the USA that's open to us, where very limited requirements. Croatia. Croatia is a nice little Mediterranean country. It's got lots of history. It's beautiful. You can do a cruise there. You can do a tour there. But it is open, and they're making it as easy as possible for Americans to travel to. Greece. Greece has been advertising all over the place. They want us to come. Greece, you can go to most of the year. Croatia, you can go to most of the year. Both countries you probably want to avoid during the winter months because it could get a little bit chilly. But they are Mediterranean, so you're not going to get those freezing temperatures like you might in the Alps. Iceland is open to us. You do have to do some tests and you know, make sure you're vaccinated. And Iceland may seem like an odd place to visit. I have been there. The picture that you're seeing, the girl in the little bowl with the ogre, that's my daughter. We went to Iceland in the winter. And that may seem like an odd time to go. But if you go to Iceland in the winter, you have the opportunity to see the Northern Lights. And it's an easy trip from the USA. I believe we even have direct flights from Washington. And I will tell you, flights are changing daily, so I'm not going to swear to that. And if you go during the summer, it's gorgeous. And they have really come to welcome the U.S. and they are allowing U.S. citizens to come visit. So that is one of the places you can go. And said, if you want to go in the winter, you get to see the Northern Lights. And I'm going to tell you all a little bit about the best way to do most trips. Italy. Italy is anxious to have us back. They are changing the rules so that we can come visit. The thing with Italy, though, is that you probably want to stay in the larger cities. I have been to Italy, and Tuscany is gorgeous. You want to work with a tour company. Some of the places in Italy, as in some of the places in Greece, you've got a lot of cobblestone streets. So if you're not comfortable walking on an uneven area or on a lot of hills, I'll tell you, when you go to some of the European countries, stay in the main cities. There's a tremendous amount to do, the kind of support that will work. And you still get to see a lot, but you want to think twice about getting into the smaller towns. And you definitely don't want to drive overseas unless it's something you're really used to doing. Paris. France supposedly is opening up to us in June. Paris is a wonderful city to visit. It's relatively easy to get around. And like in most major cities overseas, English is spoken. And this is a big thing. Because when you get outside of the major cities, unless you're fluent in the language, it can be a problem. That's one of the big pluses about the USA. You know that everybody speaks English for the most part. We all have our little accents here and there, but we know that it works. So Paris is one of those places that is opening up to us. France is opening up, and there's a lot of things you can do in France. And France, again, you probably want to avoid in the winter. I would tell you probably from April to about October is good to visit in France, most any place in France. I'm going to share with you a video. This is from Ama Waterways, which is a family-owned river cruise line. And I just want to share with you a little bit about river cruising, because it's a wonderful way to travel.
Andrea, we're just seeing it. We're not hearing it. I just heard two folks that I'll be sure to send this link out so you can hear the video.
River cruising has become much more popular in the past few years. I know everybody's heard of Viking, and Viking is fine. There's a lot of good river cruise lines. Ama is one that I will be on next year, but it's a great way. And I apologize because my slideshow doesn't always work that well for that. But it is a great way to travel. Why? Because it's smaller ships. You only have about 150 people on the ship. When you get into port, you are in the middle of the city. And ocean cruises are wonderful. The one thing with an ocean cruise is usually it's going to take at least 45 minutes to an hour to get to what you want to see. On a river cruise, when you walk off the boat, you're there. There will be other things that you can do a little bit farther away, but the river cruise is the opportunity to get off the ship and be in the middle of the action. River cruises, and this is some advantages, include a shore excursion every day. It is part of your fare. They also generally include wine and beer dinner. Some of the river cruise lines include alcohol all day long. They all have their own little niches, but the excursions are included with pretty much every river cruise line. So it's less nickel and diming at the end of the day. And also, they don't generally have children's programs. So you're going to be pretty much traveling with adults. And if you want to travel with kids, there are some great lines for traveling kids. You want to take your grandchildren. Royal Caribbean is a great way to do that. Disney is obviously a great way to do that. But if you want to travel with grown-ups, a river cruise is a great way to do it. The changing of the guard. Great Britain is opening up to us. We're not quite there yet. Technically, we can go, but if you were to go in the next month or so, you would have a 10-day quarantine. So I would tell you to think about London down the road. And that's another place you definitely want to stick to spring and summer, maybe early fall, because it'll get rainy and definitely get chilly in London. There are some unique ways to travel that I like to share with folks. And some of it is just fun because it's different. The Rocky Mountaineer is a train that runs in Canada, and we cannot travel through Canada yet. We're hoping that next year we will. And this is actually you do in the spring and summer anyway. You definitely don't, this is not a winter trip, but it's through the western side of Canada in Vancouver and Kamloops. And what you do is you ride the train during the day, see all these beautiful places, and at night you're in a 4 or 5 star hotel. Great food. They do have 3 levels of service. So depending upon your budget, you can determine how you want to travel. The gold is the best because you get the best views. But that's a neat way to see the western part of Canada. And sometimes they partner with some of the cruise lines that do Alaska. This I just thought was fun. There is a company in Europe that does a caravan of cars where you get to drive a Porsche. So if in your little dream somewhere you wanted to drive a Porsche, this would be your chance to do it. It's a slow ride. Everybody is taken care of. You go at your own pace, but you're with a group of people. And this is definitely a grown-up kind of trip. So I just thought that was fun. It's called the P Travels Club. I'm going to share another little video with you. This is in South Africa. That is the way we should be doing rail travel. And in Europe and in South Africa, you get that elegant, efficient rail travel. And just a little note, I know a lot of people think about safaris and a lot of people feel that, oh, I can't do this. It's going to be too physically hard. It is not. I've done safari. I went to Kenya and I can tell you that it's a very, except for the long flight, and this is the one thing everyone needs to think about when you take a trip, how long is the flight, or you know how many connections there might be. Once you're there, you're pretty much riding around. You can't just walk around out in the wilderness there. There are a lot of rules, and for your own safety. So it is, safari is really relatively easy because somebody's taking you everywhere you go. You sit in a Jeep or a van and you get to watch the wildlife, which is an incredible experience. One of the things I like to share is about how we travel and who we travel with. And to me, that's one of the most important things to consider is who we travel with. We should be traveling with people who are like-minded. You know, we all like to have fun and everybody has a different view of fun, but chances are most of us are not going to be partying till 3 a.m. You know, and doing wild and crazy things from the concept of big concept of wild and crazy things. So when you choose a cruise line or tour company, the idea is to choose one that understands you, wants to accommodate you and your interests. And because of that, the people that you're traveling with, and not just the person who's going to be in your cabin, but the overall group wants to do the same kind of things. They have the same interests. You know, I talked about Royal Caribbean, which is a wonderful cruise line, and they are designed for multi-generational families. So if you want to take the kids and the grandkids on a cruise, that is one of the top ones I'd recommend. They have rock climbing walls. They have ice skating. They have zip lining. I don't know how much of that we're all going to do. By comparison, if you travel on Cunard or Princess or Holland America, they're going to have lecturers. I did a transatlantic cruise on Cunard with my daughter. And they had the author of The Midnight from Garden of Good and Evil. They had a speaker from the Mayo Clinic. Things that are going to educate us. They had a lot of other things to do too. Cunard actually will have single men to dance with women when they have their ball nights. A lot of different things that you can do, but the cruise lines that I'm showing are the ones that really will accommodate the baby boomers and seniors, because they understand what we want and what we need. Some of these are the higher end lines. Some of these are premium lines. And I could probably spend hours telling you about the difference between all the different kinds of lines. But the most important thing is to remember that if you're going to travel, travel with a company that wants to support you. Tour companies. These are tour companies. Now, when you look at companies like Kensington, and Abercrombie & Kent, Audley, these are some of the higher end ones. Kensington in particular will craft a tour just for you and your partner, or just you, or just four of you. They don't do big groups. If you want to go with a big group, Globus is a great way to do it. Monograms is interesting because they support the independent traveler. They take care of the logistics. They'll pick you up at the airport. They will get to the hotel. They'll give you a half day tour, and then you can do what you want. But there's a concierge at the hotel dedicated just to Monogram's clients. So if you want to know where to eat, if you want to know what else to do, it can be taken care of. It's great for people who like to do it by themselves, but still want a little bit of support. But these are the kinds of companies that will support you, that want, that understand what you want and what you need. And when we talk about when to travel, you know, I'm sure everybody's heard of high season and low season, and there's something called the shoulder season. High season is when most people want to travel. Now, summertime is usually going to be the highest. Christmas week is the most expensive time of the year to travel. And this is because this is when the kids are off from school. So if you don't need to travel at that time, you know, you can very often get some good pricing if you travel early November, or if you travel April or May, because the kids are in school. That is a big dictator of costs. And those tend to be your shoulder seasons. Your low seasons, prices are very good, but generally it's because you don't want to be there at that time. It's too hot, it's too cold, it's too rainy. And it's not that you can't, but you probably wouldn't have a very good time if you went during low season. So if you're looking for good pricing, shoulder season, when the kids are in school, is one of the best times to travel, no matter if you're doing it on your own or you're traveling with a tour company. This to me is going to be one of the biggest things we always need to think about. How do we get where we're going to go? We can drive. And if you're just driving a short distance, you know, you want to drive up to New York or down to North Carolina, it's 4 or 5 hours. not a big deal. I know that I don't want to drive 12 hours in a day. Can I do it? Yeah, I'm exhausted. And by the end of the day, I don't want to have anything to do with anybody for the next day or so. So for a short trip, driving yourself is great. For the longer trips, public transportation, I think, is a better option. Plane travel is still one of the best ways to travel. Why? It's efficient. The air on the planes are circulated on a regular basis. And when you get to the airport, there's support there for you. If you have a hard time getting to the gate, and it may just be because you walk slow, ask for help. There are carts, there are wheelchairs, there are ways to get you there. And I would tell you to use what they offer. There's no charge for any of it, but they're there to help you. If for some reason you have a long distance, if you're on a layover and there's a long distance between the two gates, ask for the help. They're there to help you. They're going to make it as easy as they can. And when you book flights, that's one of the things, if you're using a travel advisor, which I always recommend, they should be looking out for how you're doing layovers, because that is the only issue that you tend to really have on plane travel. The other thing with plane travel is, if you have the option through airline points or your credit card, get into a private lounge. They're wonderful. They usually have complimentary dining, a place to sit and relax. It's just a good way to travel. If you can't, that's okay. It's just a plus. Trains and buses. Trains in Europe are wonderful. Trains in the USA, my opinion, based on my experience, and we used to take the train from Virginia to Florida every year. I'm not a fan, in all honesty. One of the issues I have with Amtrak is that not every station has support. And even if they do, they can't necessarily help you the way you need help. If you're traveling with a lot of luggage, you really need somebody at the train to help you get the stuff on the train. Sometimes you can pay a porter, but sometimes they don't even have the porters you can pay. So you have to think carefully about that train travel. When you travel overnight, they offer roomettes and bedrooms, which are pricey by comparison. And the roomette is bunk beds. So if you're going to just go up, again, a short trip up to New York, it's fine. The longer trips, I still think that a plane is a better way to do it. The other issue that I have with Amtrak is timing. And this isn't always their fault. They don't really own the rail lines. The guys who are transporting food, fuel, they get first choice. So a lot of times Amtrak will get held up because of another train line. So those are the things to keep in mind. It's not the absolute worst thing you can do, but I think that you don't get the kind of support that you need. In Europe, like I said, it's totally different. They have amazing train systems. Switzerland has the best, rated the best in the world. Buses, you're dealing with kind of the same thing that you are with a train. With a bus, you do have your bus driver, so you can get a little more personal contact and help, but it's not always the most comfortable travel. And again, we run into timing, traffic, any number of reasons why you may not get to where you want to when you expect to. Cruising is one of the best ways, in my mind, for seniors to travel. Why? The cruise lines want to help you. They will make it as easy for you as they can. And basically, you're on a floating resort. You know, all of your food is included. It gets you to a variety of destinations. So I think of cruising as a great way to get where you want to go if you want to see a lot of different things. But I still think plane travel is the safest and most efficient way for you to get where you want to go. And like I said, you're going to get more support in an airport than you will with the other forms of public transportation. Some tips, things to think about. Book early. The days at Les Mandils, they're gone. The cruise lines reward you for booking early. The tour companies reward you for booking early. You also, and even with flights, you also get a better choice of where you're going to be. If it's a cruise on your cabin, if it's a flight, it's your seat. And with the tour company, you got a better chance of getting a spot because they have limited spots. And like I said earlier, travel with like-minded people. Maybe you have a wine club. Everybody loves wine, or everybody loves food or dancing or books. Go as a group. When you travel as a group, often you get better rates or more, you get more perks. That's where you're going to see an advantage if you travel with a group of people. Make sure your passport is good for at least 6 months after you're scheduled to come home. And I know people, here's a question I know people ask, do I need a passport to go on a cruise to the Caribbean? Technically, if you leave from an American port and come back to American port, the answer is no. Why do you want a passport? Because worst case scenario, if you get sick, you get stuck in Bermuda or in the Bahamas or one of these other countries, you still need a passport to come home. So that's why a passport is, and it's really good to have. It's also a good backup ID. When you have your luggage tags, just put your name and your cell phone number on the luggage tags. I'm not a frightened person, but I also don't think that the world needs to know when I'm home and when I'm not. Your name and your cell phone, they'll get to you. And I say use a travel advisor because travel advisors are your advocates. We're here to help smooth out any hiccups that happen and avoid them, because we know what to look for. And why do we want to travel? We want to travel because it's fun, because it makes us better. I've got a little Pollyanna view of the world that I think when we travel, we become better and the world becomes a better place. And again, there's so many places to go. The C word. I know we've all dealt with COVID for the past year. Here's a couple of things to be aware of. Expect vaccinations and or tests to be required for any travel outside the USA. At this point, that's just what it is. The CDC makes recommendations for travel, and I'm not always sure I agree with all of their recommendations, but they make their recommendations. But individual governments make their own requirements. So if you're going to go to a foreign country, you really need to see what those requirements are. Private businesses make requirements. An example, no shirt, no shoes, no service. The cruise lines are telling you now you need to be vaccinated. Plain and simple. And the tour companies are saying the same thing. I'd be prepared to wear masks in public for a while. It partially for your own safety, but just because we don't know who is vaccinated and who isn't. And the biggest thing, the rules are changing every day. And what's happening in the morning could be different in the afternoon. It's just the way the world is today. And I sit in on a lot of travel webinars, and they all say, they all get asked a question, well, do you think we can? And everybody's answer is, I wish I knew. We just have to wait and see what the governments tell us. But we just need to be prepared. that's a little bit, that's my contact information. I'm happy to answer any questions that you might have. I think getting out and seeing the world is great. And there's a lot of different ways we can do it and stay safe and still have a good time.
Thank you, Andrea. That was wonderful. So terrific to hear about all the different places we might consider, and also just love the practical tips. So thank you so much. We did have some questions that rolled in. I'm gonna go ahead and get through those. Let's see. Well, first a comment about a cruise ship. Excuse me.
I'm having a hard time hearing you.
Okay, can you hear me now?
Sort of. Hello.
Hello, Blanca. Do you want to try? Maybe here. Maybe Blanca can try. Blanca, do you want to turn on your mic and see if it's a little better?
Yes. Hi. Can you hear me?
I can hear you.
Okay. All right. So yes, your audio's a little bit choppy. Kate, I just started doing that now, though.
Okay, so we had a question about something about cruising.
Well, it was just any thoughts on cruise lines like Silver Sea, Seabourn, or National Geo. Could you hear me on that?
Absolutely. Okay, so Seabourn and Silver Sea, excellent cruise lines. They are definitely have smaller ships. I'm actually scheduled to sail on Seabourn in October and Silver Sea in January. Very, very good for seniors, because that is who they expect on board. They don't have children's programs. National Geo is a good cruise line. The one thing to keep in mind, though, with National Geo is that the people that are on there are often very physically active. So a lot of times you're going to have other passengers who may want to go climb mountains when you want to take a tour of the destination. So that's the only difference, but they do a good job. National Geo does a good job, but Seabourn and Silver Sea are on the top of my list for good cruise lines.
Okay, thank you. And actually this same audience member commented that Alaska Gold Star train from Fairbanks to Denali to cruise ships, this person had a great experience. So just to add that to the discussion.
Oh, well, I'm glad. Yeah, Rocket Mountaineer does a good job, and they do partner with the cruise lines.
Cool, okay, great. So Andrea, someone asked, how far in advance should I be planning for a trip to Europe?
What I tell people is start planning a year to 9 months in advance, and you'll probably be booking 6 to 9 months in advance. Part of it, sometimes you can book a year in advance. It's a matter of when the hotel rooms are open to be booked. And for the tour companies to get all their rooms settled and to get all their tours in place. But planning at least 9 months in advance with the expectation that you'll get your booking done within 30 to 90 days.
Wonderful. Any recommendations on trips to South America? Any places that strike you as go-to places?
Well, Machu Picchu is one of the most popular. Again, this is one where you really want to work with the tour company. And I always recommend tour companies because they're the ones that can make it easier for you. Because Machu Picchu is an iconic place to visit, but it can be a little tough to get up there. So you want to be with people who can get you where you need to go. The Galapagos is another iconic cruise. Silver Sea, Seabourn, they do the cruises there. A lot of companies do. Celebrity does a cruise in the Galapagos. Easter Island. There's a lot of places to go. The one thing I will tell you is we have to watch out for sometimes the political situations in South America. And this is where I know I always check to see what's going on. And when you're working with a cruise line or a tour company, they're very aware. If they think it's an issue, they're going to tell you, or they're going to say, no, you know, we can't do this tour because of X, Y, Z. Argentina is another great place to visit. Chile, Easter Island. So yeah, there's a lot of places to visit in South America. Right now, South America is pretty much not open to us. Within the industry, we believe that by the end of the year, we should be able to go just about anywhere.
The Northern Lights and when?
The Northern Lights?
Yes, the best places to see them and when.
Yep. Northern Lights, actually, you can, I mean, if you want to go to Alaska, you can do the Northern Lights in Alaska. There are places in Canada, you can do the Northern Lights. Again, we can't quite get there yet. We can go to Alaska starting in June. But the best time to see Northern Lights is going to be fall and winter, early spring. So from October to about March is the best time to see the Northern Lights, because it gets darker earlier. And generally also when you go to see the Northern Lights, you need to go somewhere where there's almost no artificial lighting, because the artificial lighting kind of distracts and blocks out what you can see. But fall and winter, best time to see the Northern Lights.
Okay, hi, this is Blanca. I'll read the next question.
Okay.
Is it required now to have a smartphone?
No, but it's a really good idea. What I tell all my clients is bring a phone with you. If your phone does not work outside of the USA, or if you don't have a plan that does, you can get one. I can arrange one. There are lots of services out there. The advantage of the smartphone is that there are apps that you can use when you travel. You can take pictures. So is it a requirement? No. Is it a recommendation? Yes. Hope that helped.
Yeah, thank you for answering.
I just want to remind folks, if you have any more questions, feel free to chat them in. So Andrea, you did mention quite a few great tips. Anything else to add on the safety, like just safety around traveling?
There's so much, you know. Keep things close to yourself. Don't carry a big purse. There's some great new clothing out there where you can zip up your pockets. The idea is you don't want to invite people to try and take things from you. Also, one of the reasons I recommend tour companies and cruise lines is that they sort of protect you from those who might try and take advantage of you. If you are on a cruise and you want to take a shore excursion, whether it's a cruise line or another professional shore excursion company, you know that you're going to get off the ship and you're going to get back on the ship. If you get off the ship and you just find somebody standing there saying, hey, I'll give you a tour, you've got a 50-50 chance of what's going to happen. So the idea is, like my mom told me when I was growing up, you know, be careful about talking to strangers. We want to meet new people, but we have to think about how we're doing it and who we're talking to. So there's all kinds of things to be careful of. Here's another little tip. Before you go to a foreign country, go to your bank or go to a service and get some cash that is local to that country, you know, whether it's euros or dinars or whatever it is that you're going to get, because it's good to be able to get off the plane. And if you want to buy a cup of coffee, you shouldn't have to pull out your credit card. Also, avoid using debit cards when you can. when you travel. Just because of the cyber world, the way it is. And you also always want to let your bank know and your credit card companies know when you're traveling, because otherwise you could try and buy something, you want one of those larger ticket items, and they could stop you. Say, hey, you didn't tell us you were going to be there, you can't buy this.
One of our audience members added a tip of their own around safety, and that was to know how to contact the U.S. Embassy Consulate Services offices for wherever you're traveling, officer. So I thought that was a nice addition as well.
Excellent. And actually, you can register with the State Department, and they'll let you know what's going on.
Great.
When it comes to travel.
Another question, Andrea, may have touched on this briefly, but does your passport have to be valid for 6 months after you end your trip? Or, you know, what if it's shy of that, 5 months, or what was the rationale kind of behind that?
Well, some countries actually require 6 months.
I see. Okay.
And every country is a little bit different. So we use 6 months as a standard. You know, if you're going to the Caribbean and it's 5 months or even 3 months, you're probably going to be fine. But if, let's say you go to visit China, your passport has to be good for at least 6 months. And those rules can change too. So we just use 6 months as a standard, but it will depend on the country that you're going to.
Excellent. And we had another suggestion or tip that someone added in to only use ATMs that are attached to the bank, because some of those ATMs are not secure. Someone's some experience when they share this tip. And then one more suggestion was to enroll in the STEP program at the State Department. Is that familiar to you?
Yeah, that's what I was talking about. You enroll, you let them know where you're going to go. And I can get that link and send it to you.
Excellent.
Yeah. And I'm sorry?
I was just saying there's so many great suggestions from you and the audience.
Yeah. And when it comes to the ATMs, and it's not just overseas, actually, it's everywhere in the country. There's always that issue. If you are savvy enough and you can program an app in your phone to get money without having to use your card, it's good for buying gas too. The less times you have to put your card in a machine, the better. I learned that from a techie guy.
All right. So this is Blanca again. So that is it for the questions. If you have any more questions, please do, you can email those questions to us and we'll go ahead and send it to Andrea and have her email, or you can contact her directly too, as her information is on the screen, which you are going to get the linked the information, the presentation email to you after this webinar. So if there are no more questions, I'm just going to go ahead and close this with a short announcement for next month for our healthy aging lecture that we have on June 25th. And this is on brain health, preventing and managing cognitive decline. And that will be again be on June the 25th for next month. And that's it. So thank you so much, Andrea.
And thank you.
Great presentation, awesome information, love the pictures, and great questions too. So this is great information for all of us now that we're getting into, starting to somehow get into normal planning and start planning our trips and trying to get back to a normal life. All right, well, thank you very much, everyone, and we will see you next month. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.